the Kremlin. You burst transmitted in code. But here's the thing that the Lord really put on my heart, and this is really critical for people. The Holy Spirit's ministry is to lift up Jesus. One of the things that has been bugging me more than anything in the world, and I've said it on your show, and it's easy because it's so simple, is the fact of the cowardice of Christians that proclaim to be Christians, yet won't speak the name of Jesus, don't understand the Word of God. So I believe the Lord told me this. He said, Steve, I want you to use the word help. That's when he gave me the scripture. And help is an acronym, and I want to give it to everybody in the 10 modes, and then we'll go through it. And this is how it came to be in this order. God's everlasting, his, now just remind, his everlasting everything. His everlasting preeminence, his everlasting power, his everlasting presence, his everlasting protection, his everlasting provision, his everlasting patience, his everlasting purity, his everlasting proclamation, his everlasting peace, and his everlasting promise. Lo, I am with you, even to the end of the age, that where I am, you may be also. And then the last chapter was hope. And I got to be honest with you, there are times I lose hope, and I want to just be blunt. And at the times I lose hope, I'm reminded that Jesus is my hope. So I said, Lord, you gave me help as his everlasting and all the P words, okay? I said, what does hope mean? And it was a genuine thing. And that's when Sheely dropped into my spirit, his overcoming power every day. Well, I had looked at hope as a process of just, you know, kind of wishing that, you know, basically I make it out of this life alive, bearing witness to the Lord, and I'm faithful to the end. But I didn't look at it the word overcoming power every day. So I write on the back of it, and by the way, ladies and gentlemen, Sheila was one of the first two people that got this manuscript because I wanted her to see it as an author herself and also as a woman that takes a lot of flack because she talks about prayer. She talks about the Holy Spirit. Now, here's what I said. This book is the least religious and most down-to-earth end-time manual that you'll ever read. And it's also the timeliest. Through the candid life stories and my intimate personal struggle and victories, I'll share with you how everyone can achieve victory through Jesus Christ. And it all comes down to this, Sheila. There is no victory for the Christian apart from Jesus. There is no power apart from the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. God is not a respecter of persons, and anybody who thinks they can stand in the theology of their understanding in this day and age is grossly mistaken. There is no case in Scripture where God's people or those who claim to be God's people ever overcame the evil that now we're being faced with outside of God breaking through on their behalf. Because he is our high tower. He is our hiding place. He is our all in all. So, by the way, I believe, and I'm saying this with all my intention, I'm not writing another book. I'll do some videos, you know, because obviously that's where my passion is right now. But again, how do people even begin to grasp the serious nature of the persecution now that's coming upon the church all over the world? We see the heinous, wickedness, barbarous, demonic, wretched, satanic sacrifice of up to 9-month-old children. This is butchery, barbarism, and if this doesn't demand that Christians get off their lazy posteriors and scream at the top of the lungs or get on their face to God and say, God, I'm not getting off my face until you give me power to deal with this and to overcome it and stand for the helpless. I am sick of the meow men. I am sick of the apologists. I am sick of the surrenderists. I am sick of the weenies. I am sick of people that are absolutely such keyboard warriors that they would never speak out against evil. They've never won one person to Jesus. And by the way, as you know in my book, I deal with a time I was literally translated out of my car going at a wonderfully high rate of speed before the throne, the judgment seat of Jesus. And he looked down on me. And I'd seen Jesus before because obviously that's how I got saved. And he asked me one question. He said, Steve, when I've given you so much, why have you done so little? And Sheila, that burned in my heart. And I bowed my head, and I was a white alabaster throne, the glory of God. And I said, forgive me, Lord, give me another chance. And I was in my car 8 miles down the road, and that really happened.
Wow.
And so the thing is that I want people to understand, look, I didn't choose Jesus. He chose me. I was a perfect example of someone who is wretched, reprobate, and disgusting. And that's the nice version, okay? I never want to wallow in my sin or even brag about it. But when I got saved, it was such a traumatic thing because I was I'll just say this, I made Belushi look like Little League on campus at Montana State University, MSU in Bozeman. I was the president of a fraternity that was so profane that I think I spent more time before the conduct committee of the deans of the school. I was in film and television. That's why I graduated in with a couple degrees in motion picture production and still photography. And yet that's the point that God chose to reveal himself to me. And so, again, this book is written to people who can, the overcome word is the most avoided word in the world because most people think, you know, they're out of here. And if I get one more of the please, if you believe that you're getting out of here in a pre-tribulation rapture, don't waste my time, don't waste your time, because you should have been out of here by now. We have brethren being stoned, we have brethren being cut, slaughtered, and you know, even now, the mullahs, and they're making excuses that, according to Islam, you can eat, like cannibalize, your victims.
Yeah.
And that was one of the things, Sheila, that the Lord showed me when the end times would start. He said the tribulation starts when cannibalism fills the headlines and when the volcanoes of your day all start going off simultaneously. Yeah, she said the largest ones. So I'm excited about this book because this is my last book, and I want it to be the most blessed thing. I thank God for everything I've been able to share, teach, those have been one to the Lord, you know, those who have been brought back. My greatest compliment that I immediately give to the Lord is when people say, thank you for making it easy for me to come back to Jesus. Nothing else in my life has ever meant more than that statement. Nothing. I mean that.
Indeed. It's very, very rewarding, especially in a time where it's ubiquitous in the church that people do not know. They don't have a familiarity with the power of the living God. They've never had that experience, the powerful experience with Jesus. There's nothing else, folks. Look around. Look at the headlines. Look what's going on in New York. They stood and cheered for murdering babies. I mean, need I say more? Insanity. It's the new black, Steve.
It is, and years ago, and you know, when I've been on talk radio 25 years, I can actually make statements because everything that I've ever said is recorded, or people who have listened to me that long, Sheila, will remember this. But the point we are at now, there is no returning. There is no political answer to a spiritual solution. I want everybody, here's the word I've been given, okay? Because I always like to come on a show with a fresh word for people, okay? And I've been praying about everything that's going on in the political realm, and I want to make a statement. Probably starting no later than the end of this week, I'm switching the entire focus of my website to what I would consider important news other than politics. That means volcanoes, earth changes, geoengineering, the stuff I actually started out on radio and some TV. The point being is that I sense such an urgency in my spirit, especially with the Cascadia region, that's the entire volcanoes on the West Coast, you know, and all of the activity that's going on, the different plagues. I'm really focusing in on the great deception coming that the aliens created us, and that's the whole point of Branson, answering the alien question. And by the way, if they want to buy my book too, Jesus, A Premise of Promise, the first 500 people I'm going to autograph it for. You know, I never realized, Sheila, you probably did, but I mean, to sit down and for hours autograph books, I mean, not only do you get writer's cramp, but you go, you know, your hand just starts to shake after a while. And I was so grateful to be able to meet the different people. And this year, it's my goal at Branson. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but, you know, as everybody's outside standing to register, I absolutely want the opportunity to shake as many hands as I can. And by the way, I fist bump, not because I'm trying to be some ethnic differentiation, but because of Tom Watson. I don't play golf, but he made a statement. When he quit shaking hands, he quit getting getting sick. And so don't take offense at anybody or if I grab your shoulder, but that's my goal, to meet as many people over the 3 days as possible, starting registration day. Now, we've got some of the great speakers coming, and FYI, everyone, I'm not at liberty to talk about it right now, but I have an eyewitness whose father was big in the aerospace industry who will be speaking at Branson. He's not yet on the web page. Personal insight of reverse engineering, personal insight of what was going on after Roswell, personal insight of reverse engineering, not reading somebody's, friend of a friend on the internet, a man who absolutely you'll all recognize, and we had a wonderful talk today. He said, just hold off for a week until I write up what I want to talk about. And so we're at the point now, Sheila, where the deception is coupled with persecution, is coupled with betrayal, is coupled with unimaginable evil. Jesus said there's never been a time like it, nor would be again, and except the days would be shortened for the elect's sake, and because of that, or there'd be no flesh left alive, God's going to shorten the days. I challenge anybody to tell me that their life hasn't sped up in the last year. I want you to think back 1 year ago to whatever, January 29th, end of January, and think, where did it all go? I don't know about people that write to you and email you, but Sheila, when I talk to people, they simply say, I can't believe where the time has gone. And that's a perfect point to witness. I said, well, let me tell you what's happening. I said, the time and the way human beings process time is in the brain, but also God promises he's going to speed things up. And he's speeding it up for the elect's sake. And I want to share this. Most Christians I know are not even accurate biblically on the promises of God and don't even understand that the premise of the promise in Genesis that God was going to redeem mankind is in Jesus. And I get equally frustrated. And look, I am not claiming to be anything other than this. A sinner saved by grace, a man who has nothing except he receive it from above, somebody who Jesus supernaturally revealed himself to at the height of my paganism and my twisted view of life, total hedonistic, and somebody someplace prayed for me and touched God on my behalf. I think they probably were praying, God either save him or kill him, but, thank God he saved me, because